Thank you guys for having me here. We're going to be talking a little bit about reality today. I have a little bit of a turn or twist to kind of put on it. But I think it's important as we kind of get to know each other a little bit to understand what it is that we love, what it is that, that you guys love, what it is that I love. And since I've got a mic and you don't, haha. I'll start with me. I love the movies. I love the movies. It's what I do in my off time. I see about 120 films a year in theater. I love the movies. It has to be in theater, though. It can't be at home. No offense to home theater. It's just not the same. I need that theater. I need that corporate experience. I need the $10 popcorn. I need the 2-liter bottle of soda in a glass. I need all of it because it's part of that experience. For those 2 hours, I can't be got. I have every excuse, and it doesn't matter what's happening on the outside of that theater. Everyone will understand. Like, hey, your mom's been in an accident. I was in a movie. Oh, all right, never mind. You're like, okay, well, I totally understand. Okay, you were in a movie. There's nothing you can do about it. But I love the movies. Every weekend, that's what I do. I love the movies. How many of you have seen Captain America: Civil War so far? Only a couple of you. Wow, really? Shocking. Yeah, what time is it? When are we done with here? Don't go to work. Go to the movies. Right. I was watching Civil War, and if you followed any of those superhero movies, right, I'm watching Civil War, and I have these strange thoughts that happen while I'm watching a movie. Half of it has to do with what I do for a living. I work at Hint. We're a creative content experience design shop. So to some degree, we've been for the last 25 years a film production studio. We make that magic, not to that degree, but we have a part in doing it. And so that starts to roll into my conscious whenever I see something. I see a scene. How many of you saw The Revenant? You guys remember The Revenant? There's a scene in The Revenant. It's a single shot scene where Leonardo DiCaprio's on the horse and he's being chased by Indians. And that horse is in a big wide open plain, and then the horse goes over the edge of a cliff and he goes into a tree. And in that moment, I was like, how did they do that? That was a single shot. They didn't cut. How did they do it? I had to find out how to do it. And the first thing I did when I got back home was look up how they did it. And then you see where it's fused together. And you're like, that's not a real horse. What the heck is going on around here? And it comes up all the time, right? When you find out, you're like, that's not a real blank. And as I'm watching Civil War, I'm thinking to myself, how much of this is real? How much of this is practical effect, right? How much of this is shot in camera? And then how much of this is CGI? How much of this is manufactured?
One of the really interesting things about the film is that it's a movie that takes place in New York, but in the end, except for the aerial plate shoot that we did, we were only able to have the principal actors in New York for a couple of days. So the majority of the time that you see them, you know, down on the viaduct, down on 42nd Ave, is them in New Mexico, you know, on a green screen set.
What was very clear from the outset was that we weren't able to shoot the action as we were watching it in the animatics, and that we were going to have to create a CG playground around the Stark Tower, which effectively covered about 20 square blocks.
There's quite a few restrictions about shooting in New York and where you can get road closures and where you can set off pyro, which isn't very much, and you also have a lot of restrictions around where you can take a helicopter and do filming. You can't get below 500 feet above the tops of any buildings.
What made this project different for us was just the volume of data that we knew we would have to capture. The team shot 7 miles of streets while 100 feet above in a crane, as well as 35 different rooftops across the city, both day and night, multiple levels. It was an enormous challenge, and the data that we acquired was effectively 2,000 spheres and over 250,000 images.
from that photography, we would take the spheres in, we would project it onto the geometry, and that would give us a nice base to start from. We would get some pretty good results very quickly, but it's the details that take, you know, the longest amount of time. We'd have to go in and paint out all the trees and all the cars and all the people that are supposed to be moving, and everything that sticks out from the building would have to be painted out as well.
So there are a sequence of shots early in the movie where we're flying with Iron Man through New York at nighttime, and that presented us a bit of a different challenge because we knew, because we were flying so close to the buildings, we would have to see inside those buildings and see offices. So we actually shot photographs of all the rooms at our LDAC facility here and reprojected those onto low-res geometry in a shader model inside the building so you could actually see offices as you fly past the window.
Then down on the ground is where we had the most work in terms of recreating New York. We put back in trees, we put back in awnings, cop cars, cabs, you know, traffic, little construction pipes with steam coming out of them. In all, we had about 190 assets that we were repopulating, you know, New York with, right down to the sandwich boards on the street corners. And I think that was the real key, you know, in terms of creating New York, is you just need so much variety. And, you know, what seems kind of simple at a glance actually is quite complicated to recreate all the different pieces of.
Boy.
If you think about it, there was a great quote by Steven Spielberg who said, "We have just entered a time where there is no story now off limits. Any story can be told. Technology allows us to tell all of the stories that we couldn't tell because technology didn't allow us to tell them before, and now they're possible again." But yet, you think about it, this world of CGI, this world of fake, it's actually against our own human nature, isn't it? We hate fake. We can't stand fake. When someone's being fake with us, we're like, "Oh, I'm gonna punch that guy." We hate fake, right? We are addicted to real. We love things that are real. We want them to be authentic. Then why do we go to the movies? Why do we sit in the theater knowing that that entire world is fake? Why do we sit there? Why do we pay the money to do so? And I think that there's a misconception about why we're there. See, the actual truth is that there is something that's at work here about this idea of reality. We don't go to the movies for reality because of this simple truth. Reality's boring. We wouldn't go to the movies if all they did was just show a big camera on us sitting in the movies, would we? Right? Reality's boring. We don't want reality. This idea that, for instance, reality TV, we have a reality TV division at Hint. Reality TV, I hate to break it to you, it's not real. Okay, they tried that, and it sucked, and they were like, "You know what, that doesn't work anymore. So let's set up scenarios with which we can just take." The only prerequisite now for reality TV is that the people who are in it are not actors. That's it. Everything else is manufactured. I can't tell you how many scenes I've reset with the exact same props in a completely different room to try to make you believe that it's a new room, but it's actually a different room. There's nothing real about it, because reality's boring. If we went to the movies for reality, we would just fall asleep because our lives are boring. That's not why we're there. We're not even there to be entertained. That's not why we go to the movies. We go to the movies for something else. We go to the movies to feel. This is the reality with which we take in all of our entertainment. Movies, concerts, festivals, ball games, all of those things are meant to give us an experience. Last year was the first year in a survey that they've done over the last 25 years, the first year that across the nation, the United States, more people said that they would rather receive an experience as a gift than a physical object. They would rather go do something. They would rather feel something. Something that's fleeting, that goes away in 2 hours, they would rather have than a physical object that can stand the test of time, because we want to feel. We're addicted to it. We want it so bad. That's why we go to the movies. We don't go to be entertained, we go to be moved. In any way, there's no other explanation for the genre of horror. Why would you go to a horror film? Who wants to be scared like that? It's not that you want to be scared, it's that you want to be moved. Fear is a primal human emotion. It's one of the core four. Thank you, Inside Out. We know that, right? It's one of the primal emotions, and we just want to be moved so bad that we will sit in a theater where people are literally having their limbs torn apart and we'll choose it. We'll pay for it because we want to be moved. In our jobs, we also recognize this. Most of us in here are creatives. We make something for a living. To some degree, we make something, and oftentimes we're making them for other people's products and services. But there's a reality about their products and services. They're boring too. And it rarely even matters what it is. It's boring too. And what do we do about that? We try to make it unboring, and we try to lift it up, and we try to hold it up and say, look how unboring this thing is. But it isn't. All we're doing is trying to pull the wool over people's eyes. It's boring, right? And so we've even started to pull this idea feel into our work, right? Toothbrushes, they're boring. So we bring in the emotion of disgust in order to communicate the value of something. This has to do with feel, right? Reading glasses, they're boring. So we bring in the idea of whimsy. You feel something, don't you? Even just the littlest thing. Most of it is envy. Like, you sons of bitches, I would never have thought of that. Hate you for that, right? Here in the animal health corridor, dog food is boring. It's dog food, right? But even in this, we look to try to create something that has feel. Something, don't you? How many of you like that ad? Raise your hand. How many of you are a little peeved to find out it's an ad? A few of you, yeah. Yeah, right? A few of you. This is interesting. This is going to come up a little bit later. But you see what we do? We're so desperate to know because we know that dog food is boring. That we're just trying to bring in feel. And this is an important point, okay? We as creators, we as makers, we think that the thing that we're making are things. We make ads, we make banners, we make websites, we make art, we make things. But that is not our directive. That's not what we're here to do. We're not here to make ads. We're not here to make banners. We're not here to make websites. We're here to do one thing, and that's to generate emotion. We're here to create feel. In our work, in the things that we do every day, if we are not generating an emotion, if we're not making someone feel something, we are failing as creators, as makers. We need to be making and creating emotion. If there is no emotion in our work, no one will be moved. No one will care. We seem to think that people will care about our products or our services or our brands. We do it all the time. Oh, wait till they hear about my business. They're going to think it's awesome. Nobody cares. They care about themselves. They care about how they feel. So figure out how you fit into how they feel. That's our directive. That's our primal instinct. If you carry nothing away from this talk, carry away that your job is to create emotion. In whatever capacity you create it, it's not about the noun. It's about the verb. That's what we do. So how do we do that? How do we create emotion in the things that we make? I'm going to give you three tips, three things that we can do in order for us to create emotion in the work that we make. Number one, human first, product second. We have a tendency in our industry to think of people as audiences because we have to bucket large people, large groups of people together. And in doing so, we often forget that audiences are made up of individual people. And we forget that those individual people, they have loves, they have fears. There are things that they want to do and there are things that they're afraid of. And I can guarantee you, those are the things that motivate their behavior more than anything else. It's what they love and what they fear. That's what motivates their behavior. There is no rational message that you can insert in front of them that's going to make them care about you until you make them feel something. See, we have this tendency to lift up our products and services, our brands that we manage, the brands that we communicate. We have a tendency to lift them up and say, here is my product. Check it. Isn't it awesome? Look at all the things that it does. It's so much better than their product. Check it out. And it is, frankly, lazy communication. Because what we're doing is we're laying the emotion on them. Think whatever you want. I don't care. Just look how awesome it is. You want it. And I'm going to keep putting ads in front of you as many times as I can so that you can't forget me. What a terrible model that is, right? Instead of us holding up those products and services and trying to make people believe that they have value, let's instead turn this. This is what people really want or need. This is something that they're feeling. This is something they're struggling with. Here's how my product or service fits. Here's what it changes in their life. That should be our directive. It's a simple switch. How do we move away from this idea of rational purchase drivers and move them into emotional purchase drivers? You start with people. You back everything back up and go, our message doesn't matter, squat. They don't care about us. What they care about is themselves and how they feel. They'll care about us if we fit in. If we can actually say, we can help you with that. This is what we can do. This is what this product or service gives you. It's not what it is, it's what it does. And how does that change how we perceive that? Number two, construct a story. Story is the most powerful communication vehicle known to man. And we as communicators, we cheap out all the time because story is really hard. We can recognize story. We can even tell the difference between good and bad story, but it's really hard for us to make story because we don't exactly know what goes into it. And that's fairly accurate. Story structure is a very difficult thing. There are very complex structures and very simple structures. But it is important for us to recognize that story really is this confluence of emotion and structure. Story has a structure. And when you understand that structure, you recognize you get things out of story that you can't get out of anything else. Story provides one thing that no other medium gives us, and that's context. If you don't understand something, what do you ask for? An example. Tell me a story. Yeah, the consumers, the people that we market to and that we advertise to, they're doing the exact same thing. And yet we won't tell them a story. We just keep throwing the same equation at them and hope that they understand it over and over and over again. But if we can construct a story, if we can give them context, what we get with that context is an emotional resonance that didn't exist before. We can show them how they're supposed to feel. When that spot came up, that Caesar's dog food spot came up, you knew by the music how you were supposed to feel. You didn't have to watch the whole thing. You knew what space this was going to be in. That wasn't going to blow up. There was no pyrotechnics that were coming. And you knew it, didn't you? Because you understand the structure of story. If you're in a scary movie and there's a person walking towards a door really slowly, you know what's behind the door, so much so that you yell it at somebody who can't even understand you because you just have to communicate. You know something. See the context that it gives you. It's important for us to construct those stories. So I want to give you the simplest story structure I can give you. I'm not going to break down a 13-point story structure. I'm going to give you something that is as close to as simple as you can possibly get from a story structure. There is the world that is. This world is flawed. It is broken. And then there's you, your product, your service, whatever it is that you're communicating. And then there's the world that could be. Through that, show them what the world is. Show them what the world could be, and show them how your product, your service, your message moves them from there to there. They'll have the understanding of what it is. Yeah, that is what it is. Here's what the world would be. Oh, man, I would really love that. Then this is what gets you there. Ah, story. Recognizing that as simple as a structure that exists, if you can set this world up, you will accidentally stumble into story because there's no other way to communicate it. And it's important for us to recognize that. Third, and last, is to pursue empathy. We have much more experience creating emotion than pursuing empathy, and there's a difference between those two things. We as communicators will often say, this is how I want you to feel. Don't you feel that way? You should feel that way, because it's awesome, you should feel that way. And people are like, I don't feel that way. I don't care about you, I don't feel that way, right? But we say, hold on, look at it again. Don't you feel that way, right? This is the emotion you want them to have. I want you to feel joy and excitement about my brand. I want you to be so, this is so exciting, look how great this is. This is the emotion you need to have. And people are like, I don't have that. What do I do? Right? And we just keep shoving that emotion down there. That's not us understanding. That's us taking a position on a hill and yelling, be joyful! That's not empathy. Empathy is understanding the emotion of somebody else. You don't have to agree with it. You just have to understand it. Right? You just have to understand what it is that they're going through. You know, as a marketer in this industry, I've spent a lot of time in animal health. And we deal a lot with, I don't have a dog, we deal a lot with people who do have a dog. So when you say, hey, look, there's our product, it's great, your dog will love it. They're like, I don't care. But when you realize a simple fact that people with dogs don't treat them as dogs, they treat them as children. And they see them as children, they have the emotions of children. You're like, ooh. I wouldn't say, your kid will love it, take this. I wouldn't say that because you're going to like, I'll make sure I pick the things that my kid loves. How's that sound? They do the same thing with their dogs. So when you understand that simple thing, that's empathy. I don't have that same emotion, but I understand it. This is the emotion they already have. Most people are driven by fear. And in order to understand they're driven by fear, what can my product or service do to alleviate that? To fit into that, to understand the emotions they have and not dictate them, but simply fit into what they already have to help alleviate fear or accentuate joy. How do I do that? There are four primary emotions. Those of you who have seen Inside Out, can you tell me what the four primary emotions are?
Anger.
Fear.
Joy.
Sadness. Right? Surprise is thrown in there. It's part of fear, kind of attached to fear, but those are your four primary emotions. And in most cases, we all make our own, all of our behaviors are driven by one of those four emotions. So understanding who our audiences are as people and what their emotions actually are helps us to be able to fit our message into what they do. And when you do that, when you start with humans first, when you construct a story, and when you pursue empathy, you get work kind of like this. Thanks, guys.